And I invite Scott to continue on with this line of arguments. Thank you.
Okay.
Kobi. Meanwhile, I wanted to ask Lucian, what's your next target? Are there other things that should be temporary with an expiration date in corporate governance?
Thank you very much, Benny, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to present the FORA project, which is a joint work. Which is a joint work with Lucian. And we're going to discuss the perils of small minority controllers. I hope you will find it interesting, and I look forward to your comments. On the more personal level, I can say, I mean, Lucian mentioned the important work that he has done in the Israeli case of the pyramids, and I was involved as an RA, and I can say on a more personal level that after that project, I made an important decision in my life. I decided to leave the law firm I worked at, Midtown Manhattan, 32nd floor with a view to the Central Park, and go back to Harvard Law School, to the library, and become an academic. This is a decision I don't regret. Except when I look at the bonuses, the annual bonuses of lawyers, and then. We start. Anyone knows who are the two gentlemen, nice gentlemen in the picture? They are smiling, they have good reasons to smile.
Snapchat.
Yeah, those are the two co-founders of Snapchat. They become billionaires at a very young age. That explains why they are smiling. When they take their company out public in March 2017, it was an IPO that attracted a lot of attention because they use a triple class structure, where they issue non-voting shares to public investors and all the insiders got the voting power. And obviously it attracted a lot of attention, but we were interested in this case because of a slightly different point that didn't receive enough coverage and attention in the media and also in the disclosure documents that they provided to investors. And this is the following point. At the time of the IPO, which one of them had 80% of the votes. But what they did is that they planted into the governance documents of Snap a wide array of provisions, governance provisions, that basically will enable them to liquidate a significant fraction of their equity stake and still retain control. They will basically be able to go down up to 1.4% each and still retain control. You can ask why and how they can do that. I will explain it to you a little bit later, so you can stay tuned. Let's move to the other example. I don't think there is a need to present the gentleman in this picture. It was taken after his first daughter was born. Her name is Max. And he saw the light at that point, same way that I saw the light after the work for the committee. And what he decided to do is to transfer a large fraction of his wealth to charity. What's the problem with that? The problem is that a lot of his wealth is tied to Facebook shares. And then if he's going to do that, he's going to lose control over Facebook, despite the fact that it was a dual class company and that he had 10 votes versus one for public investors. So he had the most talented lawyers in the Silicon Valley, and they came up with a reclassification plan. Sorry. And the reclassification plan was passed in April 2016. It was a very easy move because he has the majority of the voting power. So he just had to approve the plan unilaterally. And what was the plan exactly? They decided to issue an additional class, a third class of non-voting shares, and then to distribute it as a dividend with a 2-to-1 ratio. So two non-voting shares for each Facebook share. They distributed it equally to all shareholders, so it's difficult to tackle it. And the final result of that is that right after the distribution, immediately after that, he will be able to unload 2/3 of his position without losing any single vote. And with some other maneuvers, it could go down to 4%, probably even less than that, 3, 2.5, depends on the scenarios, and still retain majority control. So that was the plan. And the plan was challenged at court. Lucian was hired to be the external expert for the plaintiff. And in September 2017, they decided not to proceed with the plan. But these two examples, they're really at the heart of this paper. And the paper, in this paper, we'd like to put a spotlight on another subset of dual class companies, those that have controllers who hold a small or even a tiny fraction of the equity capital, and we believe that they deserve special attention. And here the idea is that even some people support the use of dual class structures at the IPO for some reason that Lucian already discussed earlier, then they should be very cautious when we think about the ability to become small minority controllers and think about the way to limit it. And in the paper, we are basically doing four moves. One, we discuss the governance cost associated with these structures. Two, we discuss the mechanisms of becoming small or tiny minority controllers. Three, we discuss the incidence and provide some and collected data on the incidence of small minority controllers. And finally, we come up with some policy implications. And as Lucian mentioned, this supplements our earlier work about the time dimension, the untenable case. Now, the beginning is similar to what you have seen, what you have already seen, and so I'll go through it very quickly. And again, it's an elaboration to earlier work of Lucian from 99. And the idea is that we have a controller that chooses whether to make an action. The action will reduce the company value by delta V, but will provide the controller with a private benefit. The action will be taken if delta V is smaller than B divided by alpha. Here the focus.
Is B a constant or is it a function of alpha?
No, we define it as a constant B, right? If you are a controller, you can enjoy private benefit of controller, it's constant. And then here what happens when alpha goes down, when the controller reduces equity stakes, we see two things that are happening. A, the likelihood that the value reducing action will take place increase, and B, the expected reduction, the actual reduction in value is going to be higher in this case. And this prediction is consistent with substantial empirical work that shows the problems associated with lower equity stake, just to mention the famous work by Gompers and the work by Masoulis. And what we also wanted to emphasize in this part is that when basically alpha declines, the expected agency costs are not rising in a linear way, but they are rising in a much steeper rate. And just to give you a quick example, again, these things that have already been discussed, but just to give you a quick example that show the intuition behind it. So let's assume that the value of the company is $4 billion and the private benefit is $100 million. If we have a 30% controllers that would like to move to 25% to reduce his equity stake by 5%, then the range of situations in which the controller will take a value decreasing action will increase by $66 million. Right? We do that just by plugging the numbers in the formula that we show you. But if we have a controller that would like to go from 10% to 5%, so it's the same 5% decrease as before, now the range of value decreasing actions will grow by $1 billion. So when you go down, the distortions are substantially higher, and again, it's just putting the numbers in the formula. Now, we also saw in the paper that these structural distortions are likely to arise in a wide array of situations. The most obvious one is related party transactions, but there are other situations, allocation of opportunities, choice of CEO, choice of business strategy, scale decision, etc. And here I wanted to emphasize that the first one, related party transaction, is subject to a stricter judicial review. But all the other type of decisions are often considered business decisions, and they are not likely to be subject to a strict judicial review in that regard. Then we move to the second question, is about the mechanism, right? How the small minority controllers are created. And here we provide in the paper a roadmap of those different mechanisms and how prevalent they are. And I will go through this mechanism quickly. Some of them are less known. So the first one is hardwiring for votes or directors. And here the idea is that the controller plants into the governance documents a provision that says that the controller will always control the majority of the votes or certain percent of the votes or the majority of the directors. And this is without regard to the equity stake of the controller. So if you think about Ford, for instance, the controlling family will always control 40% of the votes, even though they have only 2% of the equity stake. The New York Times family will always control the majority of the board without regard to the equity stake of the controllers. The other point is, the other mechanism is a large ratio between high and low votes. Now, we can say that in many dual class companies, the ratio is 10 to 1, and in 10 to 1, it means that the controller will be able to go down to 9%, around 9%, without losing majority control. If he wants to hold 35% of the votes, which is effective control, it could go down to 5%, even lower. And some companies don't stop there, they use a higher ratio. Zynga, for instance, use 70 to 1 ratio. What we also see in the data is that very, very few companies use a ratio that is lower than 10 to 1. Say 5 to 1 or 3 to 1. They always, the majority of the cases, they use ratio that allow them to go down to at least 9% of majority control. And in the most extreme situation, and that's the third mechanism, they can use non-voting stock. And here the ratio is really indefinite, and I go back to this example a little bit later because that was the snap situation. Another mechanism is voluntary conversion to low vote shares. And here the idea is that at some point the controller would like to sell shares on the market to liquidate the position, to reduce the highly syncretic risk. And instead of selling the high vote shares on the market and then losing control at some point, he will first convert those shares into low vote shares and then sell them on the market. And this will reduce the pace in which his position is being diluted. So if I'm the controller and I have 80% of the votes, without the conversion, if I sell half of my position, I'm about to lose control. But with the conversion, I can sell more than that and not losing my control. Another interesting provision is the automatic conversion mechanism. And this provision is relevant when there are other IPO shareholders, which is often the case when there are VCs or other employees or people who were involved in the formation of the company who hold the high vote shares. And here, what happens is that when those other shareholders sell their share on the market, they are automatically converted. And to understand how it works, I'll give you an example. So let's assume that Ben is the founder, and I'm representing the VC, and each one of us has 40% of the votes at the time of the IPO. Together we have 80%. And what happens is that Benny, at some point after the restrictions are over, he starts selling, as the VC, after the restrictions are over, I start selling my shares very quickly, right? Because that's what the VCs are usually doing. They are in the business of that, so I'm going to start selling their shares very quickly. And then Benny, what happens to his voting rights is that the percentage is basically going to increase, even if he holds his share and doesn't do anything. The percentage will go up, there will be a bump, because I'm selling my high vote shares, they are converted, and then his relative power is increasing. What we see in reality is that the founders of Google, the founders of Facebook, they actually liquidate some of their positions, say one third of the position, but still they experience this bump. And it happens because the VCs are selling much faster, and that's caused the increase in their voting right. Another mechanism is dividend in low vote shares. So again, here the founders, instead of selling high vote shares on the market, if they don't have low vote shares, what they do is they go back and ask the company if the company has, and usually the company has, authorized low vote shares that are not issued. So they ask the company to issue them as dividend to all shareholders, and then they can sell these shares that were distributed as dividend on the market instead of selling the high vote shares. There are also post-IPO voting agreements. And in the case of Facebook, for instance, Zuckerberg had only 30% of the votes after the IPO, but he had a lot of voting agreements with other shareholders, and they agreed to vote in accordance with his instructions, and because of those post-IPO voting agreements, he had majority vote or majority control right after the IPO. The last thing we want to mention is that even if those provisions do not are not in the company charter in the time of the IPO, at any time after the IPO, the controller can make midstream changes and then adopt or strengthen or change in his favor one or more of these mechanism, and this can be done unilaterally by using the exclusive control of the controller, and B, it's considered as a deviation from the IPO terms, from what the parties agreed upon at the time of the IPO. So those are the mechanism, and now we are going back to the Snap example. So what happened in Snap? So we know that they sell non-voting shares to public investors. We know that there were also other insiders who had voting shares, the founders, but some other people. And what they did is that at the time of the IPO, they authorized a massive amount of non-voting shares that they kept non-issued. They didn't issue those shares. It was a dry powder, right? They kept them at the back. And if they're going to use that, but actually the amount was much higher, but they couldn't sell all of it because of some certain restrictions. So if you just look at the amount that they can sell in multiple rounds after the IPO, then we reach the conclusion that they will be able to sell around 92% of their position. So to liquidate the vast majority of their position, but still retain a majority control while holding only 1% of the equity stake each. Right, and this can be done by multiple rounds of dividend distributions. Now, what they also advertise in the case of Snap is that they had a sunset provision. And the sunset says that they could sell 30% of the iVote shares that they had at the time of the IPO. That may sound a lot. It was in the media and everything. But again, here's the devil is in the details. And when you run all the calculations, you understand that this sunset is meaningless. The idea behind this sunset is that they will be able to sell and go down to around 1.3% without triggering the sunset. So the sunset is there, but some sort of a camouflage in the sense that it's not, those are not real, the real numbers that and what we realize when we look at the data is that in 60% of the companies there are sunset, but those sunsets are mostly inefficient. They don't provide a stricter constraint on the ability to create extreme separation similar to what I showed in the Snap case. Now, the third question we ask ourselves is how prevalent this type of mechanism? So how many, what's the prevalence of small minority, of this type of small minority controllers in the US economy? And to that end, we came up with a typology. We had four different categories of controlling minority shareholders, of small minority controller, that's a controller that has only 15% or less of the equity stake, but again, exercise full majority control. A 10%, a very small minority controller, that someone who owns 10% of the equity stake and majority control, or a tiny minority controller, 5% of the equity stake and a full majority control. And then we look at the governance documents of all majority control dual class companies in the Russell 3000 as of 2017. And we were interested basically in 2 points. The first one is the fraction of equity capital that is currently held by those controllers. And you know, there is the beneficial ownership table, and you would expect that this data will be easily available, but it's not the case. I mean, we had to spend an hour, had to spend a lot of time to figure it out. In many cases, it is held through different trusts, and you have to go to different footnotes and try to understand what's going on there and calculate the numbers and subtract and other things. There is issue of double counting. It's really not easily readable, and we can do this exercise if we have time. We'll distribute you an example and try to guess what's going on there. I mean, it's really not transparent. The second point that we wanted to figure out is the lowest equity stake that is sufficient for the controller to maintain control. Basically, how low the controller can go and can reduce his equity stake without losing a majority control? That's the question, and this information is obviously not not reported at all.
You mean
50%? 50%, yeah. We use a conservative definition for control, majority control. We could use an effective control and come up with a different definition, but we want to be a bit more conservative here. And then the results are presented in this table. In the middle column, we see the incidence of at present, and in the right column, we see the potential incidence. So for example, we can see that there are 18.9 small minority controllers in our sample, but in the future, 91% of them could become small minority controllers. In the future, 81% of them could become very small minority controllers, and 30% of them could become tiny minority controllers. So what we basically see here is that the problem of a small, very small, tiny minority controllers is not a theoretical one. Hang on a second.
How do these all add up? This is a question I have written in your paper. Yeah. The 83%, what are you counting on?
Are you talking about that? 80.9%? That's all the controllers in our sample that has 50% or less of the equity stake. So it includes also very small and tiny minority controller, right? So that's the fourth move that we do in the paper is to discuss the policy implications of what we show or the policy implications of our work. And the first line of recommendation is to improve disclosure. I mean, here we came up with two recommendations. Hey, we say issuers should disclose in a more coherent and uniform form way the equity stake of the controllers. Sometimes this information is not available, sometimes yes, sometimes in a good way, sometimes it's tough to get it. And the second recommendation is to disclose the minimal equity stake that the controller can retain without losing control, and this is not transparent at all. We also want to notice here that the SEC Investor Advisory Committee recently issued a discussion draft that basically endorses this part of our this specific recommendation. They agree with us, and we hope that the SEC will adopt our suggestion as well. On a personal note, I think that it's going to be also nice for researchers, because then the data on dual class will be more easily available. The second line of recommendation are structural recommendations. We suggest issuers or policymakers to limit the potential reduction in the equity stake. And here we come up with different suggestions. One of them could be effective ownership-based sunsets. The other one is cap on the ratio of high-low votes, which is common in some other countries around the world. It's important to know that in the US there are no restriction at all at the moment, as you have seen. And the third option is to limit the issuance of non-voting shares. Again, we show that this exists in other places around the world. The third type of recommendations is not about the structure. So even if someone thinks that issuers should still be free to do whatever they want at the time of the IPO and they should not be subject to any limitations, we suggest at the very least to provide some protections to shareholders, public shareholders, in companies with small minority controllers. And here, again, there are a few suggestions. One is to apply stricter judicial review on the actions of the controller, to limit the controller power regarding certain issues, to eliminate the exemptions that they have, that this type of companies have from independence requirement. It might make sense to exempt majority-owned companies from the independence requirement, but we don't think that in the situation of a very small or small minority controllers, it makes sense to exempt them from the exchange's independence requirement. And lastly, there is the suggestion, which is a follow-up on a paper of Bebchuk and Hamdani, which basically suggests allowing public investors to nominate minority independent directors in these companies because of the special concerns that they create, and then this minority director will be more accountable to public shareholders. Our last suggestion on the policy part is to screen more carefully midstream changes. Basically, what we think is that for this type of action that Zuckerberg was planning to do, there should be a majority approval of the unaffiliated shareholders. So basically, the controller will not be able to initiate those changes midstream unilaterally, deviating from IPO terms, extending the control without going back to shareholders. I think I will stop here because I'm running out of time, but I'm leaving the conclusion slides up here so you can read it while Asaf is coming. Thank you.
I need to put up my slides.